most recent collection that came out this summer. And I'll start with the title poems. Ongoing repairs to something significant. All good words over and under, in between, something with roots outside the syllables, breaking code, hold your breath, word mirrors. Memory sips a dark persuasion, two parts red wine philosophy. You are pickaxing for words lodged between perception and reality. All list making of needs, grand gestures without an audience, strict pattern of translation that refuses instruction. A winter gone, a road burning, a girl at the window. Those songs about the world ending you listen to over and over, no hesitation in the abandonment. Whatever comes next, stay still. Recognize your pen and ink encore losses, sentences as fields of dark flowers, the necessary magic of the sorrow poets. Maintain the charts, throw things to the weather, wear all the red lipsticks like a sucker punch of verbs. Delete scenes in reverse order, jigsaw stars, electronic thrift store exchange rate, take confessional knife to pulse, the agreed upon version, full tilt bad news. When the consolation of philosophy becomes unfamiliar territory, rewrite silence into the undertow. The faintest light will start the day. Spider spun, feather plucked, thing to thing, what goes missing when tides win the perfect argument? Empty-handed, your nets gather speech. Words show themselves to you, but no language is yours to long for. It's like mother love debris or the myth of Twin Rivers. Photo of Troy Donahue. Armed with what you know, those stubborn examples viewed from the train wreck, blurred liquidity of all mystery, intercoastal dreary like construction paper birthdays. Scroll down to the wrong side of the law. You are perfect damaged sticks and stones. Everything extraordinary will happen to you. A dazzle of adjectives and junk drawers. You were the daughter in the backyard and the girl on the church steps at midnight. Cardboard suitcase filled with the alphabet. An extra sweater, photo of Troy Donahue. No version is real. That is the vanity of forgiveness. You only lament cruel evaluations. You are your own naked child crawling through a language you will never learn. Subset of clarity. Like the extreme critical mass of an undergraduate philosophy class, everything is held in place by the temperature of basic structure. Particles and the private how become smaller, remove the husk of reality. Between what happens and what doesn't is a crushed cult of reason. Illusions and constructions, subsets of clarity, packed and stuttering, a collage version of yourself, or a faster version of time. No direct experience, moment-to-moment perspectives. Knowledge falls in on itself, seeking existence elsewhere. You read what has not been written, listen through your skin to offshore winds, search that wardrobe of memory, dresser drawers full of broken crayons. Truth may be a color you see with no particular significance. Every sentence pitched like a tent or starstruck like Plato. Go further into what it means. Join the unknown and unmask shadow thieves. Take everything before the vendors arrive. Compromise. This is the poem I wrote just after being in London, after the terrorist attacks. Memorize this location. It's all clumsy syntax, probable knowledge, and oversimplification. Better to look both ways on Marylebone High Street than to obey those chalked-up tourist messages showing the right way to look. Tossed up by rough waters, that habit of meaning, you know that the dimensions of reality are not rules of magic. They are the singing of nine mermaids coming to terms with kinship. These summer days are loosened and slowed. You push your misgivings into the ceiling door, into the attic, where that mad woman sings her sad little songs in a thin, rare atmosphere. You wait and want and lose your balance amid rumors of self-placement. You merge onto language's exit ramp without a measured plan or map. Stand still and hold the moment as a prayer for the city. Running out of punishments. You make appropriate gestures, but will not forgive that gentle thief of anticipation who brings old hurts to sell. They are packaged like knockoff sunglasses and handbags on the pavement of Canal Street, and you are made to choose the door that opens onto a crop of metaphors in sleeping green. At the three corners, the past will break your heart, show you how small you were with that target on your back among the collective unknown, sparkle pure in a multitude of sameness, giving persuasive testimony meant for all manner of survivors. The saints of desperate causes are the few remaining ghosts. They offer their pile of bleached bones to block out the truth. So much bend and slant. What is left to discover is what you find, trapped in endless expounding, a festival of all the failed nevers, or a sullen grace like a newly woven robe. Intentions piled high like nesting bowls, purchased with a gift card for sadness. Bolder punctuation marks are drunk on the line like blinding white linen. Each word follows a question mark, but there are no answers today, just dangling conclusions. The specter of time hangs in these rooms, so much bend and slant among familiars. They conjure new narratives, collect mad stories. You were famous with your careless hair and old wounds like shadow-barked trees. Now you set up shop in plain sight without any resale value. Sky written, paper fury, afternoon music in the streets. The girl on the train thinks that time is grammatical. Figure it out. Find the angles. All the words fall in quick succession with some winter overing. The sun on the water provides a new description of vertigo verbs, while all the other words hesitate, cast about for some paradox. Light climbs those half-blamed letters leaking from the alphabet. A ceremony of the abandoned use of pronouns, a sorting of words, hacking away at the dictionary. Your little language hoard, all those lies involved in knowing the thousand ways that a verb can travel. And I'd like to finish with a poem about writing and language, although this whole book is about writing and language. This is titled Black Lines on a Small Page. 6 pennies for a lost world. All the exits are marked like words on a postcard. Breathe deep and taste the forest. It tastes like the last glass of water. Lean in. You want a new puzzle, a last bill marked paid. No tentative words or phrases. All that dusting the dust of Parmenides with his no truth warranty stance. Black lines on a small page. Your roughhouse vocabulary seeps through. A habit of meaning in a loose wash of words. Language is still your drug of choice. Talking about my process, well, I usually have 2 or 3 things on the go at once, although when I'm just had a book come out, I'm busy promoting the book, so that kind of takes a bit of a back seat. I don't write every day, I find that too difficult, and it doesn't fit my schedule half the time, but I do like to have a block of days, if I can get 3 days in a row where the house is mine. I check my husband's golf schedule and she's going, oh, there's like 3 days. And it's not like I don't have an office, because I do, but something about a quiet house that nobody else is in is very conducive to getting work done. And so I like to have a few days to just work. And I usually have 5 or 6 pads of lined foolscap going at the same time, and I'll write a line or two here and a line or two there, and then I'm piecing them together, or then they go into what I call my snippet file, which is kind of a file where, okay, this works for if I'm doing something on language, that'll work for that, so I put them all together and then I start seeing how they line up and throw some away, keep some, and start making poems. And I usually start out by sending to journals. Once I've amassed a fairly big body of poems and I chest them, I send them out and say, okay, well, and then they get accepted and think, okay, that can go in the book. Okay, we'll keep that one. And at the moment, I'm working on a chapbook of the Milesian philosophers. I know we can't wait, right? But it started out being a book about the pre-Socratic philosophers, and then I fell in love with the Milesians, and there's only 3 of them. And so I thought, well, this could be a chapbook. Maybe I'll work on that. But this was supposed to be a chapbook, so who knows where that's going. And then when I was doing the work on the pre-Socratic philosophers, I had this huge notebook of research, and someone nicked it from the library. And I guess because it was only half full, and it was a lovely notebook because I bought it in London, and it had the double decker bus on it, and somebody, I guess, I don't know, but I thought, well, I hope you enjoy all that stuff about Epicurus and Parmenides and all these Heraclitus and all these different pre-Socratic philosophers. So I didn't really scrap it, but I thought, okay, it took me a while to get back into it because I was so upset.
But, and then when I discovered the three Milesian philosophers, Thales, Anaximander, and Anaximenides, and they're very interesting. They were really the first thinkers to sort of abandon the notion that the gods were responsible for everything. They were looking for a first principle. They were looking for something in the world, something that they could look at and say, this is it. This is what everything, where everything comes from. It's got nothing to do with Zeus or any of these gods, you know, pointing at you and deciding what is happening. And Thales is so far my favorite, who thinks everything came from water, which when you think about it, back then kind of made sense. I mean, without water, everything dies. And living on the Sunshine Coast now, I'm being exposed to stage 4 water restrictions. Yeah, okay. I can sort of see why somebody would look at it that way. And thinking that everything solid came from water that solidified, and everything more airy came from water that condensed and just evaporated. And it gives you a lot of poetic license with these three, because so little of what they had to say survived. So you're not going to run into anybody and say, well, that's not what they said. So it's great, and it gives you the freedom to, like with Thales and his notion that everything came from water, so you kind of use a little fragment of what Thales had to say, and then you go off and start making this whole big collage of words that have to do with water and moisture, and it's just, you know, off you go. So who knows where it's going, but at this point it's just fun. So, thanks. Any questions?
So, let's see. Yes.
Hi, thank you.
Lovely. Super interesting. So, I'm interested in two aspects of what you just said, describing your composition process for this collection, and its title, sorry, is...
Oh, Unknown Paris to Something Significant.
So, one is, did you decide in advance that you wanted to, do you have this concept of, you know, writing in a reflexive way, so writing about writing. Did you make that decision in advance, or did the subject start to what I might call assert itself in your writing?
Well, my previous book was not quite as involved with language, but there was a lot of that in there, and I find that's often the seed to the new book, something that I rejected from the old book. Mm-hmm. And then I go back to it and go, okay, wait a minute, that's not for this one, but let's see where this goes. Mm-hmm. And so, and I love playing, obviously I love playing with language and different words, and so something that didn't fit that book, you know, can, and I find myself constantly writing language poems. It's hard for me to turn that off though, although I'm doing the research on the philosophers. And that can be tricky too, because I was always the one, you know, when you were given a project in university, or giving an essay, you know, I'm at the library 5 minutes after they've given it to you, and I just do the research. And I love doing the research. If I wasn't a writer, I could be a researcher, because I love it. But then you can get so involved in that, but you don't get out of it. So at some point you got to stop and say, okay, let's just go back this up and
So you just described them as the poems about language. Can you maybe say more about that? That's not, I'm not sure that's how I would describe them. So I'm interested in, but I'm more interested in how you
describe them. Well, for me it's more the way the words fit together or follow each other, or you might start out with a line and then that leads to, you know, you're trying to parse that now, and that gets, you know, taken up, and some of it looks like gobbledygook at some point, but to start going back into it, it takes a long time to then start piecing it together. I've often thought it might be work for me if I actually cut things up, and you don't have to have those magnetic poetry things and started doing it that way. It might work a little better, but you want it to flow as well, so you want to have some sense to it, so.
Yeah, so that's related to my other question about this composition process, and it's, you know, this file of snippets. And
yes.
So is that your how you make poems, is to assemble them via these snippets?
Yes.
That's how it works.
Yes.
So you get little.
It starts out from the full stack pages,
where I'm just writing something down that came to me, and then for that, and then I'll write, you know, on the next page, and the next page, and the next page, and then I'll go back. Well, this kind of fits with this page. So let's write that one here, and then it goes from there. And I eliminate a lot of that, and then it goes into a much smaller notebook that I. And I have this notebook thing too, where I have to have this particular notebook that you only buy at the paper store in Granville Island. That's like my notebook. And if I start running out of them, I have to stop there while I'm here, because I live on the Sunshine Coast. I'd stop there and go buy like a dozen of them, so I can't run out. So.
Cool, thank you.
Okay. Yes, thank you.
When I started university at University of Toronto, I was in psychology, and I would take electives. And one of my lectures was the work of Western philosophy, and that was the course in which I had the lowest grade. It was so foreign to me, right? And I was the only woman in the class, and I think I was the only other person of color in the class. The other person was a man, Korean guy, and we were talking in this language that I didn't understand. Okay. So I find it really fascinating that many years later. So that would have been 1982, maybe. It was my lowest grade, for my GPA right now. But that's okay, I got into grad school. But many years later, I was looking at a book, and I bought this book called Inner Structure of the I Ching. And in the somewhere in that book was a quote by Heraclitus. And Heraclitus had been my favorite Greek pre-Socratic Greek philosophy, and that course, even though everything else was completely good to me, I was like, I feel so stupid, but Heraclitus, I understand. So many years later, I buy this book in a second-hand bookstore, and I bet I love it. I don't understand much of it. It's very mathematical, inner structure teaching. And there's a quote by Heraclitus, so I end up using it as epigraph. So it says, to live is to die, to be awake is to sleep, to be young is to be old, for the one flows into the other, and the process is capable of being reversed. So I think that even though, you know, Thales is your favorite philosopher, Thales, you have a kind of a liquid, fluid,
yes,
you know, flow back and forth.
Mm. Well, Heraclitus' most famous quote is actually that he's the one who said you can't step in the same river twice.
Yes.
Because it's deflowing all the time.
Yeah,
that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm with you. There's lots of binaries in your work, in the pieces that you read to us, this exploration of binaries inside, outside.
Yeah. There's a nice kind of resonance for me there.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.